Let's go ahead and get started. Welcome, everyone. I'm delighted to introduce today's speaker, Mr. Vibhu Nair. Vibhu is a senior policymaker in the Indian Administrative Service, IAS, working presently as the additional chief secretary in the government of Tamil Nadu, a state in South India. He's also serving as project director for a large high-profile World Bank-assisted project called IAMP, the Irrigated Agriculture Modernization Project. Mr. Nair was also a member of the United Nations International Steering Committee on Global Water Operator Partnerships and a founder and member secretary of the Indian National Change Management Forum on Governance and Service Delivery. He's also been nominated as the anchor advisor to assist India's National Department of Drinking Water Supply on service delivery and establishing water operators partnerships in India. He has many policy papers to his credit and has assisted many national governments at both policy and implementation levels. So as someone who's bridged policy making and large project implementation for over three decades, he brings truly a unique and valuable perspective to today's topic. And thank you very much, Vibhu, for joining us today. We know it's late. It's a quarter after 10 in the evening in Chennai right now. And so we appreciate you joining us at this late hour.
Thank you. Thank you, Terry. And as always, it's a pleasure to be with you and KV. And we have changed and learned a lot from each other, and especially my visits to Cornell. So it's a pleasure to try and share what we have been experiencing in Tamil Nadu over the last few years. And I hope it is of value to the audience. So thanks once again for having me address your group of students as well as colleagues, and I hope to learn from them as well. So
now you can just hit, yeah, there you go, the share screen, great.
So I'm today planning to talk about our experiences in transforming parasitical systems which are involved in agriculture and the water sector. And I can divide it into three broad areas, my talk today. First, look at what was our context in Tamil Nadu, the project experiences, and then more importantly, looking at institutional transformation. So most of you may know more than I do about agriculture, about mainly even water. But there is one niche area and very crucial area about institutions which are involved in these two sectors, which are less talked about, and experiments or large scale work on these aspects is not so common. So I'd like to talk a bit about those things today. So Tamil Nadu has this peculiar phenomenon which we have been facing for the last few years. Like, we had a severe drought, one of the most severe droughts in 2017, 16 and 17. And whereas in 2015, you see the slide below, that the city, it was completely submerged with one of the most devastating floods. So climate change has crept upon us, and we have no ready answers available to us, especially in the agriculture and the water sector. And if I juxtapose it to where we actually are as a geography, we are on the leeward side of Western Ghats, so which ensures that we miss out on the main monsoon, which India is famous for. So the summer rains or the southwest monsoon misses Tamil Nadu. We receive our rains mostly in the northeast monsoon, which is winter one, which frequently breaks in somewhere around in October and starting. Actually, it's been announced to have hit the Tamil Nadu coast today. And if I, along with this geographical position, if I juxtapose the area and population, we command roughly about 4% of India's land area, but only 7% of the population is residing. So we are denser than most of major hinterland India because of probably higher levels of urbanization and development. However, if I look at our water resources, so we are one of the most water-stressed states apart from Rajasthan and Gujarat, wherein we have only about 700 cubic meters of water available per capita and about 925 millimeters, less than 1,000 millimeters of rain every year annually. And as I was sharing with Terry a little while ago, over the last few years, this has also become spatially and temporally very acute in the sense that this year, as predicted, South Tamil Nadu is likely to get much below average rainfall and the north is likely to get excessive rain. And again, the number of days of monsoon rains have also been shrinking. So we are having these episodic rains of high levels of rainfall in a very short period of time. Last in 2015 was nearly 50 centimeters of rain in a day in many parts. So this is a context which is worrying on one side. On the other side, we have nearly exploited 95% of our water resource, both surface and ground. And we had about 23,000 million cubic meters of utilizable waters. Most of it is already tied up in existing utilizations and existing schemes. So that leaves the wiggle room to be very limited to any policymaker or any person who wants to implement any of these schemes. On the other hand, therefore, on one side, surface water is unreliable. It is being sporadic, temporarily not distributed evenly. There, and even the irrigation schemes over the past many decades have not had adequate investment. So there have been a tendency for the infrastructure to dilapidate. Therefore, the people have gone to more reliable, immediate solution, which is groundwater. So as a phenomenon, we have seen that people have exploited two things in India one should be aware of. One is water is not charged, so water is free. Any landowner is also the owner of land the water under the land. And similarly, agriculture electricity is free or hugely subsidized across the country. Therefore, in a way, there is no cost to extracting groundwater. For a farmer, there's no immediate environmental cost, and therefore we find that groundwater is being overexploited, and as a result, nearly 36 or 45% of all administrative boundaries or administrative blocks are either critically or overexploited. Therefore, there is no more scope. We have had depths of nearly 300 meters. People have been drilling and boring and putting multi-stage pumps to bring out water from up to 300 meters, which is unheard of. And now it has become, in fact, even the pump sets have given up. So the technology is failing the amount of depth of water that they want to drill up to. But this is multiple reasons. One is lack of water on one side, lack of policy which could help them come to alternative cropping systems. And third, lack of reliable surface water. So we are having areas of nearly 100% groundwater exploitation, an average of 80% groundwater. This is juxtaposed on the fact that we are a hard rock belt. So, and only 27% is sedimentary. So therefore, hard rock area, we anyway don't have much scope for storing water or having aquifers readily available for exploitation over long periods is not there. So that's another natural handicap the state is faced with. But contrast this modern way of thinking, I'm also an engineer, an engineering view of things versus what our ancient or our forefathers did. This is a typical sub-basin, Varanasi it is called. And this is nearly, you have 1,000 tanks built in this sub-basin. And all these tanks are man-made, maybe about 3 centuries ago, built by our forefathers. They are these are semi-lunar, cusp-shaped tanks which are using the gradient, the natural gradient from the Western Ghats to the sea, Bay of Bengal. A west to east slight gradient is being utilized by our forefathers to capture water. So you have this phenomena. But what has happened is over a period of time with intervention of engineering, with the colonial history and then governments, we have ignored this infrastructure, which was a huge infrastructure created by the public, by the kings together, and which was a major source of irrigation as well as drinking water. And now we had replaced it by canal systems, by dam systems, etc. And over a period of time, these had lost their original shape, original storage capacity, management systems which were around these. And this is only now coming to our thoughts that maybe we had misstepped and we had forgotten the value of our original assets. From the agriculture perspective, we have a whole variety of agriclimatic zones, right from the hill zones, which is in Ooty, and I think some of the team members went there, to different soil patterns. So it is very diverse. The state is very diverse, right from the coastal belt with salinity inclusion issues on one side to the hill belt with fertility issues. And then you have the delta, Kaveri Delta, which is the rice bowl of the state. So we have this portion of the state which is providing, which is the food grain basket, so to say, of the entire state, and therefore an important part of our project also. So amongst these geographies, we have located a project, two projects, which I will introduce to you shortly. But just to give you an overview that we have this extreme variation in both rainfall as well as agroclimatic zones. And we have, I would believe, to some extent only recently, as these graphs would show, post 2010, started exploiting the natural potential which was inherent in our soils and in our climate. We have high levels of long days, long duration of sun, both in a particular day and seasonally. Therefore, we could have done better. And only in 2010 onwards, roughly, when we were with our first project, we see improvement both in the total production of rice by increasing the areas and introducing rice, maize and pulses in areas which were not earlier hitherto growing these crops. So we try to expand our footprint, try to work on yield improvements, and especially in both maize and rice, pulses, all three, we were able to have certain breakthroughs in important areas of the project in the yields, which I'll share with you a little later. But just to show you that it is around mid-2010s that we have started witnessing a change in the agri economy of the state, with a concerted effort, with new ways of thinking and innovation being introduced for the first time in the state. But overall, what were the challenges when we started revisiting, let's say in 2007, when we started on our first project? On the water side, as I was sharing, we had an issue of dwindling water resources, storage capacities, both in tanks, etc., reducing because of siltation. We had dilapidated irrigation infrastructure built colonially or post-colonial, and also as well as these ancient systems which I was sharing earlier, because of neglect, because of lack of investment, budgetary constraint, financial issues. So that was one part of it. On the other side, there was no improvement in the way water was applied. So crop water requirement was stagnant, or I would say it was worse off, because nobody was charging for water, and there was no concept of the water being a finite resource. On the other hand, somewhere around 2005 was our first episode with climate change, and recently the episodes of drought and floods alternating have increased. So we have witnessed rural economies becoming more and more at risk vis-a-vis the climate. And on the other hand, crop yields, if you look at as an average and not specific project areas, have been stagnant for a very long time. And along with people remaining focused on rice for a large part, and not being able to diversify to more commercial or water productive crops. So these were a set of challenges which are, I think, common to many developing areas. And these were true for us also. But hidden within that was the policy mindset also, which which was not able to look at these things from a multi-sectoral perspective, especially on looking at water and agriculture together, looking at water from a more holistic perspective, looking at the need to look at institutions which are delivering these services. So these multi-sectoral or multi-institutional perspectives have been a challenge for us for quite some time. And this is the environment in which we have got into two huge World Bank assisted, supported projects, roughly about $1 billion worth. We started in 2007 and we continue now as well onto the second project. So these are kind of showcase projects for most of the Eurasia and Asia and Africa in terms of the size, in terms of the innovation they're trying to do, and in terms of the multi-sectorality, which is not common. You see 7 state departments and 3 universities working on the project. And of late, we had invited Cornell also to be a partner in some aspects of the project. So we have agriculture-related universities, we have animal husbandry, veterinary-related universities, and aquaculture-related universities also participating in the project. But huge in size, we have nearly 127 sub-basins, most parts of Tamil Nadu covered, and nearly 21 million farmers who are related to project interventions or who are involved in project interventions in some form or the other. So the basic development objectives of these two projects was to enhance the productivity of agriculture off water, as well as ensure that we are building in certain systems of climate resilience into the agriculture or the rural economy, and ensuring that we are getting, and the farmer is getting an adequate buck for his money. In 3 broad verticals, one was irrigation systems modernization. As I had said, the challenge was that the infrastructure was not up to the mark, and it had been bereft of budgetary or financial investments. On the other side, agriculture was stagnant, had not seen any diversification or commercial appreciation and a movement towards new value addition. On the third, the vertical was, though these two were looked as engineering issues, there was no water resource management intervention and policy. So water resources management interventions, we got into water user associations, we got into multi-sectoral bodies to look at water from multiple angles, and then arrive at policy interventions for government. This is the broad framework in which we implemented the project. And the outcomes were of the first project, which we completed in 2015, were very heartening, and they became a kind of a model for the bank. We kind of outdid the projection when we had started on the project. We had expected a IRR, internal rate of return, and financial rate of return around 20%, but we overdid it, and we returned at 21% and 30%. So the cost benefit for the project really worked well. This was backed on substantial water resource improvement, both in terms of storage, which was as high as 9% in some sub-basins, and improvement in conveyance efficiency, but most importantly, gap areas that is partially irrigated or substantially without irrigation, those areas are large chunks of our so-called irrigated areas. So we were able to bring in a lot of new areas under cultivation, which were hitherto supposed to be irrigated, but were never irrigated. So that was a major achievement. And this was also backed upon micro-level interventions, which is common for a developed country, but we still have a task to do in terms of micro-irrigations and precision farming, which is drip fertigation combinations, along with local solutions in terms of farm ponds for that last irrigation, which is not available in high summer seasons otherwise, and local water harvesting structures, which could help in improving the water availability at crucial times. And for instance, in SRI, one could see an improvement both in water productivity, and since large-scale studies were done in SRI, I can share that data saying that we nearly doubled the water productivity in the case of SRI over a very large sample size of nearly 50,000 hectares. And that was instrumental in ensuring that we were able to cover a larger area with the same amount of water. And this was also reflected in multiple crops yield improvements, maybe in SRI, of course, since we had done a lot of work. The total project impact was nearly $400 million over multiple seasons. The similarly yield improvements could be found in maize and groundnut and pulses. Pulses, I'll come back a little later because that's a very interesting experiment worth sharing.
Vibhu, I'm sorry to interrupt. I'm going to suggest that perhaps you turn off your video so we can maintain as much bandwidth as possible for the audio and for the presentation. That's great. Thank you. Go ahead.
So as I was sharing, it was a movement to project also recorded a movement towards the diversification and getting away from the water guzzling sugarcane and rice towards more vegetables, which were more profitable as well as more water productive in the sense of comparison from the flooding rice of rice. And this was backed by marketing support, which was based on creating an infrastructure which was both agri-marketing or post-harvest groups, and then looking at if we could create a value chain right up to the customers, create more post-harvest technology interventions, etc. So on an average per season, per acre of farmers' ownership, and in some cases, when we look at horticulture, it's only a few cents. It was a substantial, nearly 3,700 rupees of increased income for these small kitchen gardens. So if I look at a typical tank system and what have we discovered as the change, if you look at these satellite images, we would realize that one, not only the water spread, the water being captured is increased because of improved management. It has also lasted a longer period. This is the end of the irrigation season, images of two different years, pre and post project. And if you look at the micro study of that area, one realizes that this has been the case in spite of the fact that nearly 75% of the people have taken double crop, whereas earlier single crops was the norm. So in effect, the projects have been declared by multiple external evaluations, by the bank, etc., to be substantially successful. But what I believe was working was an institutional transformation which made a message reach out to the service delivery organizations. And I call it that development is a quest for change, which is focused on four verticals: the purpose, the people, the process, and the practice. But the purpose of development, the purpose of a project is very crucial. And typically we have a hand-down vision, etc., but we reversed the trend. Rather than doing a hand-me-down, we had a vision being developed by our partners, by the community. So it was evolutionary, it was not top-down, it was bottom-up, it was shared both by the service institutions, the departments, and the community, and therefore it was collective. So there was a common purpose behind the vision of these projects. And therefore, any new innovation which was being introduced, or even demand management of water, those issues were better tackled. And how did we go about doing it? One simple mantra for all of us was that we were into community collaborative water management. So it is sitting with the community, deciding and walking through the water assets and looking at, deciding with them that if you look at the bottom right slide, this is where you want to be in 5 years' time, and this is where you are in the first slide. If you evaluate your resources and the direction you need to take, then you need to do the following. You need to do a water budget for your village. You need to be able to, because you have only X amount of water, you need to be able to give up your current cropping systems, your current habits, and ensure that you have enough in the bank for your children. And this kind of breakthrough, which is not normally possible in government programs, to change people's mindsets and behaviors was possible because we had that vision, the common purpose along with the community. But this common purpose in alone is not sufficient. In such programs, whenever you are involved in such programs, and I forgot to share with you that my counterpart from the World Bank, the team leader, is a former Cornell Cal PhD scholar about 2 decades back. So we are talking of similar material, but normally people are not treated as assets. We forget, we have used money, we have used markets, we talk about that, but people, to my mind, are the biggest assets, and we need to be able to motivate them. We need to first understand what makes them work, define that common purpose, that higher purpose, make them a part of it, and then lead them towards that common purpose. But which people are these? Where should you start? Normally, we have charismatic leadership in programs and projects, but nobody teaches us that the value zone is where the tire meets the road, where the wheel meets the road. It is at the cutting edge, at the ground level employee, at the extension, agriculture extension officer, at the water engineer's level, where they meet the farmer. And we need to have them oriented towards our common purpose. We need to support them. So the entire value is being created in their interaction with the farmer, and that is where we need to focus. And their behavior can be changed, as these 2 external evaluations show. Now, how did officials behave when they visited the village? So were they very officious? Were they part of the community, etc.? So we did this randomized trial. This is the same. This was done by Abhijit Banerjee, Esther Duflo, etc. So the Nobel laureates in economics last year. And they did it with us in 2009. And the findings are remarkable that between the control group and the treatment group, and the treatment group is one which was working with a common purpose, with a common goal, in a process which is driven by the people themselves. We had the service delivery organization, the extension people, working as one with the community, and the community responded that they listened to the community and they listened to the solutions the community offered. Whereas the typical bureaucracy or typical system does not reflect upon what the community really feels. And this is not true for Tamil Nadu alone. We have tried that in Maharashtra, and as you can read on the top of the slide, this is Maharashtra's Department for Drinking Water and Water Resources. And they have also said that they will look to get non-functional schemes working again, rather than looking at fresh investment for investment's sake. Looking at what could be set right first. So starting from a new perspective on water. So this is a completely new look at being a water manager rather than a water engineer. So as a water manager, you are involved in conserving the resource, both the water resource and the financial resource. So your entire perspective is changed. And the third is the process. The process, how do we develop this? How do we develop this kind of thinking in around the purpose, in the people? So picking up from Cope's learning cycle, everybody has a concrete experience. And that if the experience is utilized to reflect upon, and to conceptualize, and to be committed to a common purpose, and use that reflection to arrive at some lessons which could be learned, could be implemented, experimented, and embedded into programs, then you have a winning combination. So we called it the IVUS. I is the workshops where we explored individual concrete experiences. The workplace is the place where the learnings from the workshop are embedded into the new learning from the workshop are embedded into our new systems, in our practices. And finally, community is where we explore. So these are some glimpses of what happens in the workshops. The workshops, we try to look at what we have, what roles, what perspectives we carry as government officials, as program managers, as implementers, as extension officers, and see if we can improve upon how we are looking at the crisis we face. May it be a climate crisis, may it be a financial crisis, may it be a resource crisis. Are we looking at it without involving the community who's actually facing the crisis? And from there, we go and carry these perspectives to the community. And we formed what we call the Community Change Management Group, as you can see in the slides in the bottom row. So these are top rows of officials discussing and arriving at some vision for themselves, and then sharing it with the community and being dynamic or flexible to change that vision and arrive at community change management groups who would go forward and implement these visions. As I said, water budgeting. Normally, if economic incentives are supposed to change behaviors, what we have discovered that economic pecuniary disincentives or economic incentives are very slow and need to pinch a lot before they bring changes in people's behaviors or consumer behaviors. Whereas a sense of awareness, ownership, brings in much better decision making amongst the community. And this was visible both in the actions of the community and, more importantly, also in the actions of service delivery officers. So we saw in the outcomes what we have witnessed. Why did we get those high level of outcomes? Is because the community as well as the service delivery officers were equally committed to improving their performances. Improving by listening, arriving at a democratic way, democratization of water management, some people call it, grassroots level planning. But I would believe that this is a give and take happening between the powerful bureaucracy at the field level, which represents the government, and the powerless farmer. When there is an exchange in power between them, the balance is rebalanced, or it is, the equity is restored, and you have much better outcomes. So we had a whole host of experiments and innovations being brought in by these people. And as I said, the value is created at the bottom of the pyramid. So I, or the charismatic leader, or the government policymaker alone cannot create value. The value has to come from the bottom up, because each village, each footprint is different. So I cannot have a single standard set of rules, centralized set of rules to arrive at solutions for every village. I have 12,000 village panchayats, 80,000 hamlets. So I have no way of having knowledge to be able to solve the problems of 80,000 hamlets or habitation. Therefore, the knowledge which is in the value zone, in the people at the field level, in the communities of those villages, has to be tapped and has to be taken up for innovation. As you can see, people came up with OK cards. For the first time, quality assurance of an engineering department was certified by the community. And at each stage, and contractors were paid only after the community signed off. So as a result, in the 2015 floods, which was one in 100 years floods, we had 5,300 tanks in Tamil Nadu, which we had repaired. And you would be happy to know that only one tank breached, whereas all of them had handled capacity beyond their design capacity, because it was one in 100 years flood, and they are designed only for 150 years. So these small reservoirs withstood, and they were an example of high level of quality workmanship, which is not normally governments in the such irrigation departments are not so normally famous for. Similarly, in SRI and agriculture department, not only did the extension officers get involved in looking at their impact of the demonstration, but also ensuring that large areas around those demonstrations were impacted and that they were systematically followed up so that they could carry on whatever good techniques were shared in the demonstration could also flow on to the impact area farmers. And again, one can see this from this external evaluation, the difference in the performance, in the real performance between the treatment and the control group. Of officials who were kind of committed to this common purpose, which they had shared with the community. And as I had initially mentioned, on the other side of the design was also to involve the private sector. So we had this extensive experiment at one point of time, roughly around 2008-09, pulses prices in India had shot up and production was very low. So we invited the Tata Group, and worked on a pulse mission with them to both ensure that we were able to increase the breeder seed, the seed quality available to the farmers. On the other hand, have a proper down buyback arrangement. And that small project, it started in my room in 2009, is now a 3,000 crore company, which Tata's are running, and it is supposed to be a leader in this space. So we had been able to gel together the private sector with the government and try and utilize or leverage the best practices of either in terms of getting the farmers the best market, the best seed, and but also one. On our side, we saw a convergence of multiple departments in this mission, looking at forming commodity groups, getting the marketing department to work with the university, agriculture university and agriculture department, and then to work with the iShakti brand, which was the Tata brand. Learning from this experiment, we also did similar experiments in maize, especially with the cattle feed manufacturers. And we had very good results and additional income within the first season itself of nearly $20 million for our farmers in that three districts in which we have taken up this project. So all in all, our experiments with both horticulture and agriculture have shown us that if we can leverage the strengths of relative private sector and government sector and work in a converged mode within the vertical silos of government, then we have a sure recipe for success. On the other hand, we have this very innovative approach where much before behavior economics and Thaler, et cetera, got their Nobel, somewhere around 2012-2013, we had noticed that rice was still being used as a flood irrigated crop in our state. And some of our group members came up with this idea that if you look at, as I had shared, water is free, electricity is free, and there is an inequity. If I have a rich landlord, I have a well, so I can exploit that water and grow flood irrigated rice. So on the other hand, if we could introduce a device which could show them that the root zone, even though the top layer is not flooded, root zone still has water, we could see a change, we could match their behavior, especially at the point of decision. So what we learned was, though everybody knew there was the knowledge that water is scarce, should not be wasted among the farmers, there was a lack of action. So there was a knowledge action gap. Secondly, there was a lack of choice at the decision point. There was only one decision he could take, is go and look at the surface of water. It seems dry, it would seem cracking, and therefore switch on the motor and get the well to irrigate the water. But we felt that if we could change his and give him an alternative, have a device which would tell him that the root zone still has water, we could see a social pressure being created on him that why waste water when already the root zone has water. And this was a very successful experiment. Why I'm sharing it is it showed the innovation which came from bottom up and had a substantial impact on the water availability in our state. Similarly, since I was sharing this is multi-sectoral, I have not focused as much on animal husbandry or on fisheries, but they were equal partners in this process of getting the best out of our farmers. So whenever there was a drought, you know, animal husbandry picks up, dairy farming picks up. So we were able to introduce the better varieties and higher yielding fish in the same ponds, which were providing the last mile irrigation. So if we were able to get 100 acres of aquaculture, this was a substantial improvement in the income of farmers. Similarly, these are experiences in diversification of farmers from their rice crops to floriculture, for example, and to horticulture with precision farming, which especially for watermelon was a booming success. So this in sum has been our experience. I think I've given ample time for discussion. And I have shared a few strands of our work. The basic message, the primary message I wanted to share was, apart from the technology, apart from economics, apart from the agriculture or water resource intervention, it is very important to work with the institutional transformation, especially in large programs. And if we are involved in development, which is changing the status quo, then it is absolutely imperative to work on institutional transformation to be successful. And that requires us to look at what could be the best way to reach out to more and more people. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much, Vibhu, for that inspiring and informative talk. We have 8 or 10 minutes for questions. Those who have to leave for another class when the time comes, feel free to do so. But let's open it up now. Louise, Ned, and I will monitor the chat box and also the raised hands. But in the meantime, if we have a question, just fire away. Just unmute yourself and ask for the first question. Let me, while people are thinking about a question or formulating a question, let me just mention that Vibhu and his team have invited Cornell students to be involved in this as either to conduct their own research projects or internships. Now, the pandemic, unfortunately, has really made that difficult, or at least the face-to-face engagement with the project team difficult. But if anyone has an interest in exploring the possibility of some virtual engagement or maybe exploring some of the emerging project data for an MPS capstone project or an MS thesis or PhD, reach out to KV Raman or myself, and we'll connect you with Dr. Ravi Chandran and Vibhu to explore those possibilities.
We would welcome that.
I have a question, Terry. May I
go? Yes, go ahead.
Well, sir, thank you so much for your presentation. I really appreciate the initiative taken by the government in Tamil Nadu just to reach out to local communities. I think that's something that should happen a lot more often. But I was wondering if you guys had any initiatives or policy making processes related to invasive pests. I know that in the last year or so, fall armyworm has taken a really big toll on Indian and Nepali agriculture. And I was wondering if you had any like responses to that.
In fact, that's an interesting question. Terry and KV both were in Tamil Nadu. This was the ball we were throwing at both of them to help us come with solutions. And they had some ideas which were discussed with the government. So at the policy level, both the entire government of India has taken this on its plate. And they have come up with a multitude of interventions, both chemical and non-chemical, involving communities. And different experiments have had varying level of results, but I think they have eventually managed to control fall armyworm.
Could you elaborate maybe on that? Is it more of a chemical intervention? Because I thought pests like fall armyworm were more resistant to pesticides.
See, they have tried both. So it is difficult to be able to pinpoint because both were tried on the same farm, what worked and what did not work. But conventional wisdom is telling me that they are not able to attribute to either. But they have, to my knowledge, both have been tried and both have had some amount of success attributable to them.
Great. Thank you so much.
Okay. We have two people. Michael Snow had his hand up and following Michael, Norman Uphoff.
Hi, thanks. Thank you. Pardon me. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about the ancestral tank networks and if the projects that you undertook sort of rehabilitated those, utilized those, or did you sort of turn away from those?
So that's a good question. And in fact, that's a major learning for both large multilateral institutions, also the big dam controversy. So we have kind of gone back to our ancestral assets. So we have rehabilitated them. We have rehabilitated the management system around those tanks, revived rather, to what they were pre-colonial era, by creating these local community groups, which could look after the asset in terms of maintenance after we hand it over to them. And more importantly, also manage the water sharing subsequently. And in fact, we have had examples of 100-year-old minutes of meeting in which during drought, the scarcity and water scarcity periods, people have shared them in inverse proportional to land ownership. So for example, if you are a 5-acre landowner, your per acre allocation of water was lower than a single acre landowner. So these were learnings which were forgotten over many years of bureaucracy and technology. So we have revived those and we are focused on reviving those. And these small water reservoirs, not very small, the minimum size is 40 hectares of water spread. These are our answer to the big dam controversy, and I think they have been very successful.
Thank you.
Okay, Norman, good to see you. Go ahead. Norman, you need to unmute yourself. Okay, let's... I don't know whether you're, perhaps your audio is turned down. It looks like you are unmuted. So you might check the volume on your machine and see if you can turn it up. Hello, Marguerite.
We can't hear.
No, we're still not hearing yet, Norman.
Now you need to turn your computer.
Now it's unmuted.
Turn your computer audio on.
Yeah. Well, while we're working on that, are there?
Yeah, maybe I can ask Vibhu. You know, when we look at other countries where water is very scarce, like in Egypt. So the government policymakers, what they are saying is, you know, when you look at the consumption of total water use for 1 kilo of rice versus importing rice, you know, they've been doing this water budget values, and they find that, you know, it's better for them to utilize that land with limited water for either horticultural or other crops which use less water. And I was wondering, in the longer term, do you see any shifts in rice cultivation? Because that's a major crop in Tamil Nadu. Like, you know, if there were other sources of water in other states available, if the same land could be utilized for crops which use less water, but give you more price, do you see any policy interventions in that area to help farmers, or Are they going to continue to use, rice as the main crop, which uses actually more water per kilo?
Actually, very, very interesting. And this has been a challenge for us, and we have been grappling with it for quite some time. And what we have succeeded in our discussion with farmers is to convert the last season. So normally 2 to 3 seasons is monocrop rice. So what they have done and accepted and got convinced is to give off the last season to other crops. So that is first movement. And when I analyze and discuss with them, what I discover are two things which at times we don't realize in our policy levels. One is majority of them are subsistence farmers. So first of all, the rice is for self-consumption. Therefore, I don't see it going away so soon. That is one major handicap. Second is, because of the vagaries of climate, it is one of the hardiest crops. If they go in for a perennial crop or a horticulture crop, the loss, the sensitivity to water is much higher. And therefore, they are always using this more as a safety net. They have also realized that there is more commercial success possible in horticulture. We have been able to bring that knowledge to them. Now, from that knowledge, having the risk appetite. So we have been mapping the risk appetites now, and according to risk appetite, giving a combination of crops to farmers based on some work Purdue had also been doing. So what we are discovering is it is a function of risk appetite. As risk appetites improve, I think rice cultivation in the states will go down, and it will shift to more water-endowed states. Though I don't see imports, but definitely a shift to more water-endowed states.
Okay. A comment and then a question showed up in the chat box. A comment from Professor Tom Ostinos said he was glad to see that what we discussed theoretically, we meaning he and his colleagues who've taught water management for many years, what they've discussed theoretically for the last 40 years about community involvement in engineering design and water management is successful in practice. So that's a comment from Tomo. And a question from Jesse Hughes. She would like to know if the Indian government is looking at incorporating other traditional technologies, like the tanks that you talked about, into formal policy and funding for agriculture.
Just to respond to Tamo, in the drinking water sector also, I mean, Jasper is sharing with them, in the drinking water sector also, we did a extensive exercise of similar nature of getting community involved and looking at their response to user charges. And that was a RCT, which was done by Abhijit and Esther, and then they got cold feet because the results were very stark, which eventually we published. The results showed that community, when it was involved, decided on a better level of user charges than user charges which were imposed centrally. And the revenue collection was also much higher. So, say, I mean, adding to what you have been teaching, I think even in the drinking water sector, there is a published now, we have done this, and this is across 450 villages. It's a huge sample of an RCT. And coming back to the traditional water methodologies, I think this has now been firmly entrenched into government policy. So government is now doing a two-track at the national level also. That on one side, it does believe that maybe there are certain parts of India which require this technology, this large basin transfer of water. I wouldn't say that they have disabused themselves of this idea. So that's very much there. But parallelly, they are also supporting all these interventions which are localized, which involve the community, which involve tradition. So it's a kind of two-track policy which is happening, I think, and it makes sense. Because again, you can't have one size answer for the entire country.
Thank you, Bibu. And unfortunately, Norman was unable to get the audio, so I'm asking a question on his behalf. And he's asking whether the Tamil Nadu state government is trying to calculate some value for water saved in irrigation, and then to figure out how to reward farmers and communities which save water through practices such as SRI that you referred to in your presentation.
Hi, Norman. Great to see you. I can see you on the top of the screen. It's good to see you. I hope you're doing well, especially in the pandemic. Take care. And that's a very good idea. Unfortunately, we haven't reached that level yet. But I think maybe in our participation in Cornell, this could be one of the research topics. And if we can have something to back us up, this could be the way forward. This could be. I see that it would gel with policymakers if it is backed by good research, and it shows that behaviors can be changed with these incentives, which are linked directly to outcomes achieved in terms of savings of water in the field. Because one of the major beneficiaries would be the electricity grid, because people would pump less water out, and electricity is completely subsidized for agriculture. So there is a straight incentive possible. We have talked about it, but we haven't had the research to back us up. So if there is something happening with a common student, I think this will go a long way.
Thank you. And again, let me, on behalf of all the attendees, thank you very much, Vibhu, for the presentation. We know it's late in the day there. So we truly appreciate you joining us, and we hope to see you again either here in Ithaca or in Chennai once this pandemic runs its course. So thanks again.
Thank you, Terry. It was always a pleasure. Thank you, Kiwi, and always great to reconnect with both of you. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye. Thank you.